So the argument is that brains can fluctuate into existence spontaneously because statistical physics allows it and quantum physics allows it. And I think there's a lot of problems with this argument for various reasons. One is that we've never observed it happen. So maybe you might want to ask questions about your laws of physics if they make predictions you can't observe. It is interesting cases where people try to use this as cosmological bounds on like properties of the universe and stuff. So I think that they are interesting as a conceptual tool, but I don't think it's a physical argument. And it's interesting how the Boltzmann brain argument has permeated logic of other arguments that people want to make about the nature of life and mind and how they relate to physics. It's not like a culturally isolated phenomenon. It's like people really intrinsically think the universe can generate anything anywhere for free. And I think that's tantamount to intelligent design because it basically says the universe has information for every object to spontaneously fluctuate into existence anywhere at any time. Where is all that information? Please tell me. Okay. People want to tell me in the audience I like this. Okay. Got some arguments coming. I'm excited. All right. So where do brains come from? Well, if you deconstruct a brain and look at its past history, brains are products of evolution. Right? So they have a long lineage. So this is a very abstract representation of a brain. It's a human brain, but just imagine, you know, like it needs a body. So I'm not saying brains can be disembodied. So I'm just drawing a picture because I like drawing pictures. They're helpful. it's really hard to get the art right though. So minds don't spontaneously fluctuate into existence. They are assembled across time through evolution and selection. So if you think about every step to make a mind, to build a brain, every step takes time. And you can't compress all of that time into an instantaneous, spontaneous fluctuation. A mind is an object that requires time to be constructed. And evolution is the process we know that does that. And so part of the structure of the theory that we're building to explain life talks about objects as being assembled over time. There's a particular way we talk about assembly as a construction process. But the idea being that every evolved object has a structure across time as far as how it is built. So if you start from elementary building blocks, the way we think about it mostly is from molecules right now. So I'm doing a big reach right now by talking about brains, but it's supposed to be a general theory of evolution, and we're working our way toward universal features of the theory. And I have some promising stuff while we in both labs going on right now. Okay, so if you think about a mind, and you actually look at how you can construct the mind, that is the physical structure of the mind. This is going to be the argument in the whole talk. It's not the instantaneous object of the brain, but the brain is an object that is very large in time. And I'm going to say this over and over again, but this is sort of my conception of evolved objects. They're informational, and you can't see the informational properties because they are ones that have a size in time, not in space. So this is a mind. Now, I'll explain a little bit more in a few minutes about how we think about how to construct this kind of space. So I'm doing it very conceptually here in a quantitative framework and as far as the theory that we're building and like the principles of the theory to kind of do like assembly theory 101. But one important feature of this is once you deconstruct an object in this way, you can see that it's been selected out of a very large space of possible objects, right? So if I took a brain apart, and, you know, I wanted to look at its pieces, the molecules that make it. Those molecules could be assembled in an exponentially growing space. Every time I add two pieces of a molecule together, every time I form a bond, the size of the space gets exponentially larger. If I get to the size of cells, you know, the space is even larger still. And once I get up to brains and technological civilizations, that space is very large. And it is so large, I don't even think that we can even imagine how big that space is. So remember I said that we can't even estimate how many possible molecules there are with the known periodic table of elements. So a brain actually is very deep as far as it's structured. But then as you're building up this space, you see what a huge space of possibilities that a mind exists in. And in some sense, the brain has carried with it that entire history. It's just rolled up in the present. So it has some capability of understanding the structure of the full space because it's a combinatorial space and it has some remnants of it stuck in the brain. When you look at that combinatorial space, there could be other minds in that space. And here I'm showing two kinds of brains that exist on our planet. which exist in the same combinatorial space and in fact share a lineage up to a certain point in their history before they diverge from each other. So if you look at the causal chains of events, of operations or construction processes that assembled our brain, and you looked at the one that assembled an octopus brain, there would be a lot of overlap. We're not that dissimilar. But if I looked at my brain and somebody else's in the room, we're even more similar, which is one of the reasons we can share experiences with each other, is because we're practically the same object when you look at us deep in time. Now, the reason for taking this approach when we're thinking about origins of life, and I also think a lot about alien life, is we need to generalize beyond life as we know it, I think, to understand a lot of the properties of life as an abstract feature of our universe in the sense that we talk about in theoretical physics. So if you think about the sort of paradigm of theoretical physics, like the paradigm framework of what is theoretical physics about. It's about building abstractions that unify as many parts of reality as possible under a similar conceptual framing, right? So motion is a good example. You know, I could look at all moving objects and I don't care about their color. I don't care about their shape. I care about their mass and their velocity, right? So what abstractions matter for talking about unifying motion is mass and velocity. And those are inventions of our theories that correspond with measuring devices. What I'm saying here is when we're talking about evolved objects, the abstractions that matter are this kind of depth in time and also its relation to other objects. But I'll talk specifically about concrete observables in a minute. But the reason for doing this is because we don't think necessarily, at least in this day and age, and I hope is the topic of this conference, that the only minds that exist are biological minds, right? I'm not sure that I'm convinced any AI right now is a mind, but other people might be. But we do care about technological minds and we care about alien minds, right? What is the space of possible minds our universe can construct? I think this is a really relevant question and an interesting question for reframing some of the ways that we talk about the nature of mind. And obviously that's an important, you know, very pressing conversation that people are having now. So when we think about where we exist in the space of possibilities and how we interact with the world and that other things have co-evolved with us on the same planet, there's a whole bunch of trajectories through this space that we don't know. And those are, you know, maybe technological minds that might be evolved from our same chain of event, our same causal chain constructed over time, or they might be alien minds that have completely different histories than we do.
All right, Toalites, we've got an exciting announcement for you. We want you personally to join us for 2 days of discussions, of debates, all happening at the inaugural Dissidents Dialogue 2024. This huge event will take place in Brooklyn, May 3rd and 4th. We'll be joined by leading thinkers like Richard Dawkins, Steven Pinker, Ayaan Hirsi Ali, John McWhorter, Constantine Kissin, Francis Foster, and many more. You can see them on screen here. You can see them on the website. Join us for a gathering where everyone is part of the conversation. Conservatives, progressives, secular people, religious people, left, right, everything in between. Dissidents Dialogues presents a rare opportunity to immerse yourself in a conversation with some of the most influential thinkers of our time. We'll tackle important topics relating to religion, science, politics, and culture. If you're driven by curiosity and a desire for the truth, including even uncovering what truth is, then Dissident Dialogues is a place for you. It's not just an event, it's the beginning of an intellectual journey. I will be there personally on May 3rd and May 4th, and I look forward to seeing you there. We want you to come along for the ride. Dissident Dialogues is a place for dangerous ideas. Buy your tickets now at dissidentdialogues.org and be a part of the conversation. If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.